Well, good day, ladies and gentlemen from Washington. I am Robert Christian, and this is the Robert Christian Show. On today's live show, ladies and gentlemen, we have a special guest that is joining us, and we are going to be talking about dementia, Dementia 101, and what you should know, what you should consider, and what we should actually know as a society. This and more upcoming on the Robert Christian Show. Stay tuned. And it is a lovely opportunity, ladies and gentlemen, to, of course, to be with you. Let us take a look at some of the news items, ladies and gentlemen, that have been making its debut today on the news. The Pope's comments, Pope Francis' comments, appearing to question the authenticity of Donald Trump's own Christianity and Christian faith, have some conservatives running to the candidate for defense. What do you all think of it? Did you actually hear this? Being a Catholic myself, this news item states that I have earned the identity by going to Catholic high school and college. My whole training and learning is Catholicism. And I'm very disappointed in the Pope for coming out against Donald Trump, said actor John Wright in a text to Fox News yesterday. Men in the cloth, or men of the cloth, rather, should not get involved in political campaigns, he said. And I wonder what really is going on with that. I'm Robert Christian. Stay tuned.
You're watching The Robert Christian Show. We'll be right back. Stay tuned.
And now it is time, ladies and gentlemen, to have a little bit of fun. Looking at the news, poking fun at maybe some of it, or really, should we, shall we? You be the decider. Oh, God. And once again, thank you to the viewers of the live show today, ladies and gentlemen. All right, let's take a look at the rest of the news, folks. In today's first hour, Dorothy Kuhn, and the subject of dementia. Many questions come to mind as to a cure, care, and of course others. So do stay tuned on today's live show for that. And in today's hour too, the U.S. Supreme Court. We're going to be talking about this, and this is definitely a hot ticket issue and item like you've never heard. But the Supreme Court, the scale of justice, is it now one-sided? With the cases before the court, now will it be biased with absolutely zero challenge? A court that is 50-50, will that ever work or not? We're going to be talking about that, ladies and gentlemen. Oh, my heavens. Now some of the news. The outside of the court, mourners left flowers and jars of applesauce as a nod to Scalia's dissent to the Supreme Court in 2015, the decision to uphold Obamacare, of which many think that was a disaster on wheels. We're going to be maybe getting a little bit about into this today. In the second hour. However, he also wrote the majority's opinion that was pure, as they say in quotation, pure applesauce. So people are leaving applesauce there at the facility where his body is. The funeral service, however, is scheduled for tomorrow at the Basilica of the National Shrine of the Immaculate Conception. The Justice son will also deliver the mass for his father, and Vice President Joe Biden is scheduled to attend. From Dallas, Texas, America's influenza teen. Did you get this? Did you all hear this? Come on. I don't know what it is about this guy. Anyway, this teen had his case transferred to the adult court system on Friday, where the 18-year-old Texan Ethan Couch faces decades behind bars if he violates the probation deal that kept him out of prison in the first place, prior to him going to Mexico. Judge Tim Makos in Fort Worth transferred the probation supervision for Crouch, and he was convicted in juvenile court back in 2013 on charges related to the crash that earlier that year. When he was 16, Crouch will remain in custody at the Tarrant County Jail as procedural matters are sorted out, according to the judge. He could serve 120 days in jail for violating the terms of his probation by fleeing to Mexico last year. Did you also note this? And he stands a chance of serving some 40 years in prison for what he did. On Tuesday, a U.S. District Court ordered Apple to break its security protections on iPhone linked to the San Bernardino attacks, drawing the company into one of the most important legal fights of its life. The legal precedent is serious, but there's also real concerns even after creating the software that could be dangerous. What do you think? We are talking about unlocking the iPhone. I don't have an iPhone. But some techies will say, hey, what's the big deal? You know, just, hey, it's a simple thing. Well, it's not so simple. And at last, Kentucky clerks and the Kentucky Senate passed a bill on Thursday to create a separate marriage license and forms for gay and straight couples. The primary purpose of this legislation was to remove the names of the county clerks from the marriage license in response to the Kim Davis controversy. The Rowan County clerk removed her name from the license after she was jailed for refusing to marry same-sex couples. But Republicans control the Senate amid the bill to show their support for traditional marriage. They're Republicans. And after gay marriage was legalized nationwide last June, former Democratic Governor Steve Bashar, he replaced the words bride and groom on the license, and now it just says first party and second party. Really, are we now in a party state? What do you all think of that? Ladies and gentlemen, oh my heavens. We got to do something better than that. What do you all think? All right. And thank you. All right, folks, we are pleased on today's show to have our special guest with us today. And I want to be able now, let me see, here we go, to introduce Dorothy with us. She is joining us, ladies and gentlemen, and we're going to be talking about dementia. And there are some things that people just don't understand about it. Welcome to the show, Dorothy.
It's a pleasure to be here, Robert.
You know, after the news segment, sometime I have to pull my hair out, and I really want to get aggravated and angry, but I really can't do that. I don't have much left. So, hey, Dorothy, let's get into the issue about dementia, because there is an awful lot that people do not understand when it comes to dementia. So in a short form, give everybody a good class teaching on what dementia actually is.
Well, that's a great question, Robert. And the effects that dementia has on your life are one part, and what causes those effects are another part. So to the first part, the effects are a detrimental degrade in your ability to remember and to think and to problem solve. And remembering comes into words, whole conversations. Problem solving comes into the ability to put pieces of those things together, to really make meaning out of them and move forward. Those kinds of things. And then on the other side, what causes it is that your brain tissue is dying instead of being nourished and living.
So what is the number one misconception when it comes to dementia?
The number one misconception is that current medications can really help with dementia. But the Alzheimer's Association, on their site, they say current medications cannot cure Alzheimer's or stop it from progressing. And we see those medicines advertised in glowing terms on television on a daily basis.
You know, there are millions, I would imagine, of Americans and hundreds of millions, more than likely, around the world that suffer from dementia. Now, would you consider dementia in itself a disease? And if so, is it treatable?
Right now, well, it is considered a disease. Once someone has been medically diagnosed with dementia, the progress of the disease has gone to such a stage where it is dis-ease in a major way. And once it's been diagnosed, there is very little that we can do. In fact, Dr. Samuel Cohen, one of the top researchers on the planet at St. John's College, Cambridge, said just last year that 114 years after the first Alzheimer's patient, we've made essentially no progress in treating Alzheimer's disease. The first Alzheimer's patient was a lady named Augusta Dieter, and she showed up at Dr. Alzheimer's office in Frankfurt, Germany, 114 years ago, and she could not even recount the most basic facts about her life. And the best he could do was make her as comfortable as possible and observe her as she went miserably. And it's essentially no different today, although we can make people a little more comfortable these days.
Well, let me ask you this, and it may be on a personal note, but how has dementia affected your personal and private life?
That's a great question. So I am the healthy kid in the family. When my father was diagnosed with dementia, I thought that was something that he was, you know, not taking good care of himself. I made all kinds of excuses because nobody wants to think that could happen to them. I was in complete denial about what could be possible, because when we have a family member then who has dementia of some sort, then we are at higher risk.
So how do you deal with it on a personal note? Because, you know, a lot of people, and the reason why that I ask that is because a lot of people within families that have dementia that is in their family, in their bloodline, much like, you know, high blood pressure or something like this, what happens is that a lot of times family members, they themselves are suffering as a direct result. They don't know how to deal with it. They don't know how to cope with it. So what would you suggest?
Well, there are some really great books on that, and I'll give you an example from my own family's life. When my father was suffering with it, he had an unusual form. He didn't have Alzheimer's. He had Lewy body disease. And so that's just the same thing going on in a different part of the brain. And the aspects of that were really difficult were night terrors, wild movements at night. He got to the point where he was so loud at night that he couldn't sleep in the bed with my sweet stepmom. He had to be, you know, at the other end of the house, and with wild and flailing around when people are older, you don't want them to fall out of bed. So he had to be a bit constrained in the bed, which you might think is a bad thing, but it's much better than falling out of bed and breaking bones, you know, when you're an elderly person. So he got to the point where that was going on for a while. And then, you know, when you're losing brain cells day after day and you can't put things together, you know, he would do things like take a coffee cup and put it on the burner of the stovetop, on the burner, turn the burner on high and wander away you know, a danger to self and others. And so that's the point where she had to really look at how to get him into long-term care. That meant that she had to liquidate, you know, all the assets that that they had, you know, except for the home. They lived in a state that has that, you get to keep your home, which was a good thing. But she had to buy the last car she was ever going to buy, et cetera, et cetera. And she's, you know, a vibrant go-go gal, so she's got a long way to go. And so that he could be put into a home where he could be taken care of 24 hours a day. They're very expensive. Those costs are anywhere from $75,000 to over $100,000 a year.
And that's...
that's a lot of money.
You're right, it is. You know, so how do these families afford that kind of care?
Well, when families have those kinds of assets, then they can, you know, afford that care. But there are so many families, particularly as the economy has been rough on people for the past few years, then a lot of people just don't have that wherewithal. They end up relying on family members, and that's a whole separate cost, because those are family members who can't work, because somebody always has to be with the person in those final stages of dementia.
You know, I've heard of people, you know, actually, you know, a private, a very personal note, folks, this is the first time you'll ever hear me talking about it, but my step-grandfather, I so remember him having dementia. He beat up his nurse. He physically battered her, beat her up, stole her car, and was found crawling on the interstate freeway over 100 miles from home. How he got there, that's the question. But, you know, so it does play a lot of horrifying tricks on people, if you were to use that term. And so then these people are in a very vulnerable situation. Dorothy, what can be done to keep these people from being in these vulnerable positions?
And by these people, I presume you mean both the person with dementia and the caregivers who are trying to do their best.
You bet.
Yeah. So that really is a very tough situation. And, you know, the one thing to know, when I was struggling and had big memory issues myself, then, you know, I was absolutely doing the best that I could. And so I know from personal experience, I was never diagnosed with dementia, praise God. But... when I was in my mid-50s, I was in a place, I was working in corporate at that time. So just a little backstory here. I was working in corporate, and I went in a 3-year period from being, you know, a top achiever to being on written guidance for, you know, insufficient performance and being a candidate for layoff. And that's about the time that I found a way to recover the brain function so that I could remember again and that I could problem solve like I always could. So by the time the next layoff came around, I, you know, having been on that list, I was a candidate and I got laid off. So those are some of the kinds of things that personally happened to me. But back to my dad and the people such as your great, what was that, your step-grandfather?
Yes.
So those are situations where people really need to understand what are the ways in which this particular person with dementia is acting out. And some people with dementia do love to escape. They feel trapped, and it feels existential to them, as best we can tell looking from the outside. And so those are situations where having very good security measures so that people can't escape, and to have other caregivers come in pairs so that the likelihood of an attack is much lower. And demented people don't attack other people because they're being mean. They attack other people and their own caregivers because they're a perceived threat. And they're not an actual threat, but they perceive them that way.
You know, I look at dementia. It is sort of like the lost grail, if you will. Excuse that expression. When it comes to medicine, there isn't a whole lot that has been done about it. Very little treatment is actually offered, and perhaps it is because maybe there has not been enough money by the federal government to invest in treatment, care, and prevention to help people to further their life and to make sure that they are taken care of even after the fact that someone would be diagnosed with it.
Well, I would agree. In fact, the Alzheimer's Association agrees. They are always looking for more funds because the impact to our population as a whole and to families is so great. It's a greater impact than almost any other disease that we have. We've made so much progress in cancer, for example, which is great. And that progress just hasn't been made in Alzheimer's. In fact, when Dr. Samuel Cohen was making his comments on the TED stage just last October, he was really calling for, you know, his call to action was, we need more funding. We've got some beginning research that looks like it could turn into something meaningful for people who have been diagnosed with dementia, and what we really need is enough funding so that we can take it through. Because as you know, the cycle for creating new conventional drugs is a 10 to 15 year kind of cycle.
Oh, absolutely. And then, you know, it's not just the drug creation, right? But then it is the marketing. Then it is the FDA and their approval. And suddenly, you know, 15 years down the road, you might have a new boy on the block when it comes to medication for folks. So let's take a short break, Dorothy, if we can do so. And then when we get back, we can talk about what is on the horizon for people with dementia. Is there a light at the end of the tunnel? How about that?
Sounds good.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, this is the Robert Christian Show, where your voice, your opinion, they matter. We'll be right back. There's that take great pride in their God, their gun, and their Bible, and in that order. Well, ladies and gentlemen, it is Friday once again, and the Robert Christian Show will be live and on the air, ladies and gentlemen, beginning at 3 p.m. Pacific. That is 6 p.m. Eastern. Today we have an incredible and a powerful show that is on tap, and we want to invite you to be a part of the show. Join us live. Go to robertchristianshow.com/live. Choose Channel 1 if you are using a mobile device like a cell phone, iPad, iPod, whatever, and Channel 2 for PC and other. Folks, the Robert Christian Show, it is more than just a simple progressive talk radio. All right, ladies and gentlemen, hey, welcome back to the live show. And you know what? Guess what? For those that want to know how out there the show actually is, and we are, you know what? Hey, here's a good overview as to what is upcoming on the live shows. We have an upcoming show on the 4th of March, and people are going to love this. Talking about conspiracies. Ooh, we're going to be getting into some of the juice of conspiracies. Does that sound tasty? We're going to have a show specifically dedicated to politics, okay? We're going to be talking about Congress, the Senate, all this, okay? You get the gist. Lovely. Attorney David Pesara returning back about his documentary, What About Men? And that is a documentary about what happens to men that are also in abusive relationships. How lovely is that? And then, oh my goodness gracious, we are very blessed, very honored to have Dan Dodson, the fast-talking auctioneer from Storage Wars LA, which is seen on the A&E television network. He is going to be joining us again for the third time. So, Dan Dodson, love you, but you know what? I've got to get into practice, right? To talk like an auctioneer, like Dan does. Of course, there's only but one Dan Dodson. All right, folks, we are back with a live show, and we want to welcome back our featured guest today, Dorothy Kuhn. And Dorothy, we have been talking a lot about dementia, but even so, we haven't even been able to hit the tip of the iceberg when it comes to this issue. What is it, do you think, that people really should know about when it comes to this this disease?
One of the things that's really important to know is that dementia is not like a normal disease that you would think of. You know, it's not like your bronchitis. You know how bronchitis goes. You're
right.
Feeling fine, and then you don't feel so good, and then, oh, you feel pretty bad. You go to the doctor, right? And they give you some medicine, antibiotics and such, and a couple of days you're feeling pretty good again, right? And then it's 3 or 4 weeks, maybe 5, and you're back pretty much to your normal self. So it's a handful of weeks, soup to nuts, you're done. Dementia's pattern is not like that. It's not measured in weeks. It's not measured in months. It's measured in decades, 20 to 30 years in advance of symptoms showing up, dementia has started. So my dementia, or I say my dementia, my memory and focus issues, which were huge and really disruptive in life. I was never diagnosed medically. So those memory and focus issues started in play in my 30s, give or take, because those issues really started to show up in my mid-50s. And when they did, you know, I went from being that top performer to, you know, not doing well at all, losing the respect of my peers, losing some confidence in what I could do and wondering what in the wide world of sports was going on.
Well, so you have had not just personal experience with dealing with a patient with dementia, maybe a family member, but there are other people I know here in the States, maybe even in the same town where you live, that are suffering with this just the same, yet they don't know how to act or how to react to it. Much less they don't want to put mom and pop in a nursing facility that would help to take care of it. And here they are at home with their family members, their loved one. And they're like, okay, what now? Now my life is literally on hold, as a result of this issue. Do you find that as to be true?
Yes, people really do find themselves and it's important to care for a demented loved one in some way. And if they're staying at home, someone has to be with them all the time. It's a huge impact for the family on their time, their ability to earn income, and their ability to be happy, because most people with dementia, I mean, life with a demented loved one is just an emotional roller coaster. You know, when you can't think well, when you can't remember things, it will feel to you like life is coming to you blindsided. So when I was suffering from those really disruptive memory and focus issues, people would, you know, I didn't really notice how snappy, can I say bitchy on your show?
Sure, sure, sure.
Okay. Well, y'all, I wasn't just snappy, I was bitchy. And I didn't mean to be. I'm normally a really, you know, happy-go-lucky kind of gal. I have a very positive and sunny outlook. But guess what? When you don't remember something and somebody will come in presuming that you do because you actually had that conversation, it can feel like you're being blindsided. And how do we respond when we feel blindsided? Yeah, we can tend to snap. So I was an overall happy and optimistic person. It's just because I have this really deep-seated belief that anything can be solved. And that served me really well to get from those things that could have been the beginnings of Alzheimer's or some other dementia. You know, I was never diagnosed, so it's speculation to see to imagine what it would have been when full-blown, because I did take those steps to stop the damage and get and make it resolve in a way that is possible when you don't let it go too far.
Well, you know, Dorothy, what really discourages me and really what hurts me personally is, you know, okay, you have a loved one, you have a patient, you have somebody that has dementia, but too often what I have seen, even videos of on YouTube of all places, is the absolute abuse by these caretakers that take care of these people with dementia. You know, family members getting very short and very sought off and, as you said, bitchy. Very hostile toward the person with dementia, if it is a family member or even a friend. And here you are getting very hostile with them, and to the point where it's almost abusive. Dorothy, where do these caregivers, where can they go for counseling themselves? Because surely anybody would know that dealing with a patient with dementia, that is a draw, it is a pull on someone's own psyche. What do you think?
I agree with you. You know, it's true of us as humans. Each of us is capable of great goodness and great evil. You know, I mean, if somebody was threatening the life of my kids, even so they're grown now and off on their own, if they were threatened, you would not want to see my mama bear claws. It would be dangerous. And if it's the same for all of us. We're really wired that way. And when we feel threatened, and caregivers can feel that level of threat or incredible frustration, particularly when the emotional roller coaster has just been, and here's how that emotional roller coaster really plays out. You know, in the one minute, a person with some degree of advanced dementia can be sweet, and another minute, another thought will come into their head that they don't even know you, that you are there to steal from them, except, you know, you hear about these examples. And they happen on a regular basis, and then they're very angry at you. And then a moment later, you know, that passes, and the next thought is that you're being sweet to them and they're being nice back. That kind of emotional roller coaster just wears on people, and the best preventative for abuse, as you mentioned, is to make sure that when you're a caregiver that you have got some downtime, some break time away from that person so that you can, you know, go for a walk, watch a funny movie, do whatever it is that you need to do to have that self-care. You know, a big famous book for Alzheimer's care is called The 36-Hour Day, because that's what it feels like. It's kind of like having twins or triplets, you know, that's need all day long. Ah!
Well, you know, it's not like, and you know, this is something that I want to get across, is that people with dementia, patients with this illness, with this disease, you know, it's not that they are all bedridden or that they all are wanderers and they just wander outside and God only knows where they end up. But it is our obligation, and I say our, it is the community at large, it is everyone's obligation to ensure their safety. If you see someone that is just wandering, you know, look, you know, stop them, be their friend, gain a little bit of trust, see what's going on with them, because, you know, you could actually end up saving a life. Dorothy, what do you say?
I agree 100%, and that kind of human-to-human interaction and care can really transform people. In fact, when I finally learned to do that, just to people that you might bump into at the grocery store, you know, you never can tell how hard somebody's day has been, and just to look in their eyes and really see them and give them a smile will transform somebody, and it's a wonderful thing for people with dementia who are just doing the best they can, and they're, if they could do better, they would.
Dorothy, I'm the world's worst. Because I would go to the store, even to the pharmacy, my local pharmacy, and this lady, I love this lady. She is absolutely just the bomb for me. And I will, you know, go get prescriptions and things, and I'd say, okay, wait a second. I've got to get my hug now. You know, come around. And she will literally run around the counter. She did that, you know, flailing her arms up, wanting to give me a hug. And I'm sort of like one of those kind of people. I like to give people, strangers, a hug and say, hey, you know what? We're all in this together and we can do this. You know, hey, your day isn't that bad. It could be way worse. It could be better, but come on. And it turns a frown, you know, a sulking inside innards into a happy-go-lucky person.
Mm-hmm. I'm with you, and I do the same thing. When there are not enough hugs in the world, and being able to extend that kind of social love and affection to somebody else can really make the difference in their day.
So let's talk about that, Dorothy, because you hit on something, maybe inadvertently, because even these people that are suffering with dementia, these patients that are suffering with this, family members and friends, all right, folks? But you know what, Dorothy, they oftentimes, as I understand it, they may not be the most sociable people. But maybe that's exactly what they really need, is to be out and amongst people that greet them, that are happy to see them, happy to sit down with them and talk with them, visit, have a soda, have a cup of coffee, and just enjoy life, rather than people just overlooking them and thinking, you know, well, it's those kind of people.
And getting people out and being social really is very important. That feeling of isolation, you know, we're very social people. People are just social animals, so we need the connection of other peoples. And so when we're too much alone and not touched, not hugged, not cared for, when our hand isn't held, then it makes us feel very disconnected. That exacerbates the whole, you know, likelihood of difficulty and abuse, one way or the other, in a relationship with someone with dementia.
Now, switching gears, Dorothy, have you dealt with and within the medical field for understanding or treatment, maybe of a friend, of a family member, for someone that you know that would have dementia?
So, well, that was my father. You know, he had Lewy body disease, and when he was still at home, you know, he would be somewhat friendly. With Lewy body, he was pretty good during the day. It was at night, you know, until on toward the end, that he was the most difficult to be around, with all that flailing and such, and shouting. He would never remember those night terrors, but anybody else in the house would. In any event, it was difficult, and it's hard to see somebody that you have known as vital and really loving and a great person to really become just a shell of themselves. It's like, you know, almost being a ghost of yourself.
Well, you know, it is very sad, Dorothy, and a lot of people, they need to have and at least get some sort of a better understanding on dementia and really what's going on, because, you know, it simply put, it is not the fault of your loved one. It is not the fault of your friend. And they may not know what's going on or what's happening. And trust me, if you ask them, hey, do you like what's going on or what's happening with you right now? They'd say absolutely no. They don't understand what's going on. They are reacting to a reaction, more or less. And Dorothy, it really puts a lot of people on edge.
It does. And so learning to take those breaks so that you can breathe deeply and give yourself some, you know, some significant downtime, you know, an hour of quiet. I don't know if you meditate, Robert. I started it just a few years ago, and it's a huge godsend to help me through the difficulties of life. We all have difficult moments, and you want to get those resolved within yourself and kind of dispatched as quickly as possible so you can really live your life as fully as possible.
Well, I think meditation is a great thing. You know, if people can do it, if people that are even for caregivers, if they spend a few moments every day in meditation and to make sure that their heart chakra is right, make sure that their body is in tune with what's really going on, to bring comfort and peace even to their own heart. Because, you know, trust me, it has got to be a very difficult deal, of course, to work with. Dorothy, hang on if you will. We're going to take our last break, ladies and gentlemen, for this hour. So hang on, Dorothy. And we, ladies and gentlemen, it is, there's a lot of good questions, a lot of good thought that is going on into today's live show. Nonetheless, ladies and gentlemen, this is the Robert Christian Show. Visit us on the web. Yes, we're there at robertchristianshow.com. We'll be right back, ladies and gentlemen, right after this. The Robert Christian Show live in Seattle will return. Stick around. Did you know? Hey, folks, welcome back to the show. Mike Nagoda. Some of you remember Mike. I liked Mike, and I still do like Mike. He is a fantastic blues artist from Toronto, Canada. He is going to be joining us once again. Hooray, hooray, on an upcoming show, by the way. And Marilyn Redmond, she is a spirit medium. We're going to be able to talk with Marilyn again. You know what? We had a lot of requests. It was kind of amazing to me, but we had a lot of requests to bring Marilyn back after she did just recently was on the show. It was to me, it was mind-blowing. And I truly enjoy that. I like to bring guests back to have had. If they are a hit, an absolute hit, well, trust me, they get an invite coming back on the show. Because it's people like that that have something really that they want to share and to say, something of value, something of substance that people react to. For every action, there is, of course, a reaction. So lovely. Okay, we are back, ladies and gentlemen, with our featured guest, Dorothy Kahan.
Hey there.
You know, it's the beauty of live radio and television, because that's, you know, when I do live shows like this, it is a combination of radio and television. And I've spent over 30 years in it, and I need to retire. I think that people would be like, hey, yeah, go ahead, retire. You know, but even my the guy that I've looked up to all along in media, he's still at it. So if he is still at it, I've got to still be at it, I guess. So, okay, Dorothy, so what can families do to prepare for dealing with a very evil, to the core, disease like dementia?
That is a great question. And the number one thing they can do is when, as I did, you see those early signs in yourself, to take the steps to make them resolve before it gets too far. And, you know, I was just so fortunate and blessed, really, to be able to find that. You know, there, when you're losing brain cells, there is something that's causing you to lose those brain cells. And the thing that causes most dementias, not all of them, you know, this is this doesn't address necessarily our football players who are whacking their heads inside those big helmets of theirs. But for most of us, the thing that causes dementia is a weakness in the blood-brain barrier. And when, you know, there are always things that are in your bloodstream that are necessary and good there that do not belong in your brain tissue. When that blood-brain barrier is weak, those things will seep out in a way that damages, really over time, blows up your brain cells. You look at a picture of a normal human brain, and, you know, it's large, it's fluffy, it's fully formed, you don't see any dark patches. You compare that to, you know, the same size brain, fast forward through stages of dementia. It's shrunken, there are dark areas. That's where a lot of brain tissue has been lost. So the question has been, what's triggering that brain tissue to die? So there are some things that can trigger brain tissue to die. One of them is those brain cells are snapping along doing what they do, and if they are overfiring way too much, guess what? Their options are to exhaust or die. So there are strategies for that. There are also those things that seep out of the blood-brain, of the bloodstream and into brain tissue, that just destroy brain tissue over time. And one of the questions was, what could that be? And are there things over which we have control that so that we can change the trajectory, like I did? So, you know, I was really struggling with memory and focus, and I don't anymore. I keep my practices every day. And so there are certain foods that in me, and we'll talk about the common foods that most people share that are low-level inflammatories that, you know how you'll have, sometimes you might have a rash on your skin? Mm-hmm. Low-level inflammatories, I have a relative who has Sjogren's disease. And so that's an inflammatory response kind of disease as well. There are lots of those kinds of diseases. When it shows up on your skin, for her, it shows up in her mouth tissue, in her eye tissues, they're too dry. But if it shows up in your brain, you're not going to feel it, because in your mouth, in your eyes, on your skin, you have pain receptors. Guess what you don't have in your brain? There are no pain receptors in the brain. So you're not going to notice the damage that's going on like you would with another inflammatory response, autoimmune kind of disease. So the three foods that I would recommend when people are beginning to have trouble and brain fog, difficulty thinking and remembering like they used to. You know, they don't need to remember like somebody who's like better than them. They need to remember as about as good as they have in the past, right? It's the comparison with your past life that counts, or your past days, rather. Mm-hmm. Past life means something entirely different, doesn't it?
Oh, yes.
So anyway, those three foods to really take out are milk products, that's cow and goat milk products, like including butter, ice cream. Gelato was a killer for me. I remember the day I realized I would never have gelato again. It was not a good day, Robert. But guess what? The next day I shook it off, and I asked myself, what else could I have that I can have that's even better? And I found something, a non-dairy ice cream made out of coconut milk. It's fabulous. I like it even better. But so milk is one thing. And you can remember these three with this, I call it the MSG formula. Milk, soy, and gluten. Those are three very common inflammatory. So no milk products, no soy products. And soy is ubiquitous. It's in all kinds of things.
Oh, yes, it is.
Yeah, reading labels is important. Like even salad dressing. You know, if you buy salad dressing off the store shelf, chances are like 90%+ it's soy oil in there. You don't want that. No edamame, no miso, none of that stuff. And then gluten products. And gosh, gluten is in all kinds of things as well. So making those kinds of side steps, pardon me, so that you've got other food choices gives you the opportunity to kind of expand your palate. And here's some good benefits, side benefits of stepping away from those foods. One, you'll probably lose some weight because those are high calorie density foods. So
like I need to lose some weight? Come on. Okay, go ahead.
I did. When I stepped away from those foods, I lost some weight, and I was really glad for it. And then two, I don't want to be inappropriate. This is a benefit that you will find once a day when you're in the bathroom. So just saying, things will pass easier.
Well, you know, yeah.
Should I be more explicit than that?
No, you know what? There is, we've got just a couple of minutes left, Dorothy, but there is a lot of medication that absolutely will stop you up.
Mm-hmm.
I was, after my surgery, I had both feet operated on, but after the surgery, here I was at home and I was recovering. Okay, well, guess what? You could go to the bathroom and think, hey, okay, well, maybe things are going to be just fine. But, as a direct result of the medication, though, it had a tendency. Anyway, it stopped me up bad. So to the ER I went. It was that bad and that severe. So folks, don't think that maybe that you would be immune from something like that. But something that I do want to shed at least a little flashlight on is people with dementia when it comes to surgeries and recoveries. Because they may or may not understand what's going on, may or may not understand why it's taking them so long to recover. But there again, for some folks, it is a catch-22. Dorothy, we've got just a few minutes to left of today's show. What do you think about that?
Oh, that is true. Some of the very earliest signs that, looking back in my past, I could see were bothering me is the very subtle things that were very early signs. I couldn't put it together and make sense of it, but this shoulder over here, in my early 40s, it was bothering me all the time. And, I just try to get it in a comfortable spot. People noticed, they would like, what's wrong with that shoulder, Dorothy? I never could get it fixed. Doctors had no idea. But once I got that problem with that intense memory and focus problem resolved in my middle 50s, then guess what? This shoulder feels fine now. So that ability my damage is up over here because, this side of the brain controls this side of the body, right?
Right, right.
And so that kind of segues us into another of the strategies to help you recover before you've gotten so bad that it's worth a diagnosis, which you'd never want anyway. Who would sign up for that? is to do cross-lateral movements. When you go for a walk, like swing your arms. Think about how babies crawl. Those are the kind of movements that you want to have a lot of because they're very activating for the brain. And an activated brain helps you get lots of circulation, etc.
Well, I think the more active that people are in their adulthood, when they're in their 40s and 50s, I think the more active that they're going to be when they're 80 or 90.
It's true. Activity is tremendous. We are made a unified whole. It's not like one piece is you know, off over here and disconnected. That doesn't happen.
Dorothy, I failed to mention your website, and how can people get a hold of you if they would like to get a hold of you in the future?
My website is Live Dementia Free. That's LiveDementiaFree.com. And when you go there, you'll get, you'll be able just to put in your first name and your email address. What you'll get is how to compare like normal senior moments to signs of dementia. And that's really so helpful because after 50, people will have these momentary, like you walk into a room and think, why did I come here? And a normal senior moment is to have that come back to you in just a few seconds. Or if it doesn't, you can backtrack to the room you came from, and then it'll come to you. But if it doesn't come to you at all, or it's a day later or something like that, or a long time later, then those are things to be concerned about. Just one example of many.
Well, I would encourage folks, if they would like more information from you and to do research, to contact you and to talk to you about it, because there of course is way more to the entire matter at hand than just what the content is on one interview with you. But Dorothy, would love to have you back on an upcoming show. That is absolutely for certain.
I would love to be here. It's been great to be with you, Robert.
I mean, I like to be cutting edge, and you know, I think I'd mentioned to you in an email that we have to date never, at least at that point, had done a show on dementia. That was one issue that we never have in over 30 years of broadcasting. So this definitely was a first for me, and I'd love to have you back on as a return guest.
It would be a delight to me. Thank you.
All right, Dorothy. Well, in the meantime, I will let you go, and I will contact you to let you know what the link is to the video once that the video is put up on YouTube later.
Excellent. Thank you.
All right. Thank you so much, Dorothy, and it is great to meet you and great to have you on. All right, ladies and gentlemen. Well, what a unique opportunity that it truly is, folks, to have Dorothy on, and I would encourage anybody and everybody to visit Dorothy and her website for that, because folks say, you know what, there is more than what meets the eye. There really and truly is. We have upcoming, ladies and gentlemen, on the live show. Oh my goodness, are you all ready for this? Because in the second hour, are we ever going to have fun? You think? Yeah. The second hour of today's show, we are going to be talking about the Supreme Court. From one issue on this side, that now we're going to be talking about this. We're across the scales today, talking about the Supreme Court. And ask the question, has the scale of justice now become one-sided when it comes to the Supreme Court? And, of course, with the cases before the court, how biased will the court actually be? With no challenge, mind you. Folks, this is the Robert Christian Show, where your opinion, your voice, they do absolutely matter. And, we have a lot of stuff, of course, going on in the wide, wide world that we live in. And hey, I want to encourage you, ladies and gentlemen, to do your part. So do help to support the Robert Christian Show by letting your family, your friends, your neighbors know. Hey, guess what? They are actually on the air, by jingos. They're on the air today, and this is what's going on. I mean, come on. What does it take? 3 seconds, right, to send out a like or a Facebook note or a Twitter. I mean, come on. Hey, you never know, right? All right, folks. We have, again, and I want to thank Dorothy, our guest, for being on. Dorothy Kuhn, for being on. And, yeah, we'll have Dorothy back again. You bet. When? I don't know just yet. Nonetheless, hey, folks, we have an awful lot of interesting tidbits in the news that I didn't go into before. But if you're good, and if you're nice, I'll see what I can do, ladies and gentlemen. I will see what I can do about getting you in tune with some of that. We'll be back, ladies and gentlemen, right after this. This is The Robert Christian Show.